Since we have studied lay time, do you know the difference between dry cargo lay time and tanker lay time? Do you know what are the interruptions for tanker lay time? In this lecture, we're going to look into these. Hey, what's up? My name is Akash from ShipScope, bringing you the best platform to learn about the commercial shipping subjects. In the Chartering 101 series, we have seen the basics, we have covered the dry cargo chartering, and now we are into tanker chartering. In today's lecture, we will be looking into tanker lay time. If you're new here, consider subscribing it at any point of the time. Also, check out the notes and links in the description below. And guys, if you like my content, you can always head to my website and get the whole thing downloaded. The whole package consists of comprehensive lecture notes, which we have been studying. And right now, the past ICS papers, the past question papers, which are being solved by myself, and my own lecture notes, which will help you to understand the subject very well. So what are you waiting for? Let's get into the topic, shall we? Hi guys, welcome to Chartering 101 by ShipScope. So in today's content, we'll be studying about the tanker lay time. So the first topic we are going to touch about the lay time. How much is lay time allowed? When do the lay time start? Then we will be studying about the interruptions to tanker lay time. And finally, we'll be doing one lay time calculation problem. Lay time. Lay time is the port time available under the voyage charter for a charterer to carry out the cargo and associated operations, which includes waiting, loading, discharging. Okay. If lay time is exceeded, the charter may pay demurrage. In tankers, now we are studying specifically on tankers. In tanker chartering, if the full lay time is not utilized, owner does not pay dispatch. So there is no concept of dispatch on tankers, which is one of the major differences between dry cargo and tanker lay time. Lay time applies only to voyage charters. Lay can is a tanker arrival window, that is the time between tendering. NOR, which is your notice of readiness, and the cancellation date and the time listed in the charter party. This window is very short, sometimes only one day. Ship may turn up earlier to ensure that they are on time, but no demurrage is paid to the owner for this. Lay time allowed. The most usual length of lay time allowed for both loading and discharging on tankers is roughly around 72 hours. Based on the world scale are terms and conditions. This is reversible lay time. An addition of 6 hours is allowed to tanker charters in almost every charter party as NOR time at every port of both loading and discharge. This NOR time refers to the 6 hours needed by a charterer to prepare the berth and shore installation facilities after the vessel has tendered the NOR. Thus, a two-port load, two-port discharge charter will allow 72 hours plus 12 hours. So 6 hours multiplied by 2, which will be 12 hours here, and 6 into 2 will be 12 hours. In total, there will be 24 hours. So if you add these 24 hours to the 72 hours, we'll end up getting a total of 96 hours. Commencement of lay time. Lay time commences after a vessel becomes an arrived ship and according to the charter party terms. It should be considered as the time that the vessel arrives at an agreed place. It is more onerous, it's more difficult for an owner when a berth is specific. Example number 2, berth of Ras Tanura. That is berth charter as in the port charter. If the vessel berths on arrival without delay, there cannot be disagreement to when the vessel is ready and the clock starts. But if there is a delay, the situation is less clear. The English code holds that the vessel must be within the commercial area of the port, and this legally means the normal waiting area for a port. The time will start to run only if a valid NOR is given. This is very important in this. For the NOR to be true, the ship must be an arrived ship and must be in fact be ready to load and discharge at the time that the NOR is tendered. If weather is conditioned not satisfied, example bad weather, the NOR is untrue. So weather plays a very important role in the Tanker chartering. NOR, which is untrue, is not sufficient to trigger the commencement of lay time, and the NOR will not become automatically valid when the ship does not arrive or does become ready. So what are the things are there which interrupt in a tanker lay time? It is vital to remember that tankers only active when discharging shore pumps and ship's bumper. So first of all, we need to understand, guys, when a ship arrives, while it's loading, the shore pumps will start pumping the cargo from shore side to the ship side. So there is no activity from the ship. But in case of discharging, the tanker ship is supposed to use their own pumps to discharge the cargo. That is where the ship's pumps out comes in. Without agreement to the contrary, once lay time has started, it should continue uninterruptedly until the completion of the cargo operation, until it has expired. The tanker industry almost universally adopts the 72 hours, which is Sunday holiday included, because in tankers, there are no holidays. They work 24 hours. The Ezba tank voyage charter party includes the occurrence in which the time so lost will not count as lay time, which is in clause number 7. So what all interruptions are there? Usually the interruptions to lay time under a tanker charter party are caused by the swell. There might be swell preventing a smooth connection between the hose and the ship's manifold. Electrical storms that might cause lightning to strike present danger to the tanker operation. Or there's a shifting operation from the anchorage towards the vessel's first berth, if the vessel is not yet on demurrage unless otherwise specified. When tanker lay time finishes, in accordance with most tanker charter parties, lay time usually ceases at when the hoses are disconnected. To that, we may add waiting time allowed for documents to be placed on board, usually which is 3 hours. Lay time calculation. So before we get into the lay time calculation, guys, I would recommend you to have a calculator with you, a pen and paper, and your own phone. Use the statement of facts below to calculate the total lay time and demurrage due, if any, for the motor tanker Athena. Following information is given. Lay time at the load port shall not commence before 0600 hours local time after the vessel is reported and ready. Lay time shall commence upon the expiration of 6 hours after of such notice, or upon the vessel's arrival in berth, whichever first occurs. Total lay time in running hours is given as 72 hours. Demurrage rate given for the problem is $10,000 per day pro rata. Relevant clause. So this is a rider clause which hasn't put. What it says is, time consumed by the vessel in moving from loading or discharging anchorage, even if the lightering has taken place at the anchorage, to the vessel's loading and discharging berth, or in discharging ballast water, or breakdown of ship's equipment, will not count as lay time. Okay, discharging of ballast water is again important. Breakdown of ship equipment will not count as lay time or time on demurrage. So whatever statement of fact, I mean, whatever events which happen in statement of facts regarding this will not count as lay time. And finally, per weather working day. That means the weather should be fine throughout. This is the statement of facts for the load port and the discharge port here. So on date 23rd July, Saturday, morning 3 o'clock, we arrived at Lagos. An NOR was tendered and the vessel was, the motor tanker Athena was waiting for the berth. On Sunday, 24 July, at 3 o'clock, anchor away, and the vessel started proceeding towards the berth. It was all fast on 24th itself at 6:30. At 7 o'clock, tanks were inspected and deballasting was commenced. At 7:30, the hoses were connected and loading commenced. At 9:30, deballasting completed. On Monday, the next day, the vessel finished slow loading operation at 23:30, but the hoses were disconnected on the next day, which is 0030. 1 o'clock, the documents were on board, and 2:30, pilot away. That is what the whole loading operation was. Now, in case of discharging, the vessel arrived at Rotterdam on 11th August, Wednesday at 2:15.
NOR was tendered and it was waiting for the berth. On Thursday, on 12th August, morning 6 o'clock, there were strong winds, heavy swell, and that is why the whole port was closed. It reopened again on Friday 13 at 12 o'clock. Saturday 14th August, the vessel got instruction to, come into the berth. So it anchor was away and it proceeded towards the berth. All fast at 9:45. Alleges were taken at 10:15 and it started discharging at 10:30. But there was a pump failure. Now in case of discharging, as I said, the pumps are taken care of by the ship owner. That means the ship. So it was a issue from the ship side where the pumps failed on Sunday at morning 1 o'clock. It got rectified till morning 5 o'clock. Ballasting commenced at morning 6 o'clock. Discharging complete at 10 o'clock. The hoses were disconnected at 10:45. Vessel sails from the berth at 11:30. And pilot away was at 12:25. I would recommend you guys to take a snapshot of this question because we'll be referring back and forth. We need to note some things before we proceed towards the question. Note, the clause which excludes shifting and equipment failure as the time on demurrage, even if the ship is on demurrage, and then a pump failure occurs, demurrage is suspended for the time lost because this term is used under once on demurrage, always on demurrage. If this term happens, if the vessel is on demurrage, any issues from the ship owner's behalf will be exempted while the calculation of demurrage. Normally in the tanker charters, there is an expression provision where no demurrage is payable in case of fault of owner, as I said, if the vessel has already gone on demurrage. In this case, shifting is excluded from the demurrage, the rider clause which had been put. In the absence of expression provision, the maxim once on demurrage, always on demurrage stands. In this case, there is an expression provision that excludes shifting and places the onus on the owner. Owner's fault may be taken to suspend the running of the demurrage even if the charter does not expressly provide for this. Where owners have acted for their own convenience, charters cannot be expected to pay demurrage arising from the owner's act. When owners remove a vessel already on demurrage from berth to take on the bunkers, demurrage was to be suspended as owners must do nothing to prevent the vessel from being available at the time at the disposal of charters. So it is a standard practice. Ship owners can't take their vessels, even if it's for bunkers, taking bunkers and all. And if they take out, they will remove the demurrage from their own behalf because this is some special request which is being put up by the ship owner. The first thing you need to make sure is you need to know this format of lay time. Make sure you have a date, day, starting time, what time it's going to end, lay time, days, hours and minutes, and what are the remarks. On 23rd, the vessel arrived at Lagos and it tendered NOR at morning 3 o'clock. After 6 hours, till 24 hours, it starts counting on Saturday itself, 15 hours. On Sunday, from 000 till 3 o'clock in the afternoon, lay time to count. Why we stop at 3 o'clock is because the vessel got instructions to proceed towards the berth. So the shifting time, this is the shifting time, won't be considered, which is from 3 o'clock to 6:30. On 24th Sunday, 6:30 to 1700 hours, the lay time shall count. What happened at 7? 7, deballasting commenced. And as per question, if you read, deballasting is not supposed to be taken into account. So that is why from 7 o'clock to 7:30, not to count. On 24th Sunday, 7:30, loading commenced irrespective to deballasting, and that is where 4 hours 30 minutes come into play. On 25th, on Monday, it runs perfectly fine for the whole day, so there is a whole one day lay time to be counted. On Tuesday, again, the loading operation finishes at 23:30, but our hoses are disconnected at 0030. That is where you have to be careful. Till that time, the lay time is supposed to be taken. And if you add the whole figures here, we get 2 days, 11 hours, 30 minutes for the load port lay time. Now let's calculate for the discharge port. Same format again, guys. On 11, the vessel arrived at Rotterdam and it endured in Noor at 14:15. Exactly after 6 hours, which is 20:15 till 24 hours, lay time commence. On Thursday, from 000 to morning 6 o'clock, lay time is counting. On Thursday itself, on 12, from 6 to 2400 hours, port is closed because of the weather. They were because of the strong winds, heavy swell, port is closed. It reopens on the next day at 12 o'clock. From 12 to 24 hours, again, the lay time starts counting. Finally, the vessel gets the orders at 8:15. So from 2400 hours till 8:15, lay time is counting. From 8:15, the shifting time comes into play. And it goes to the berth at 9:45. That is the point where it's all fast. On Saturday, 9:45 till 2400 hours, lay time just counts. Until on Sunday, there was a pump breakdown at 1 o'clock in the morning. From 1 to 5, the vessel is stopped. Now, how do we come to know whether it's on demurrage or not? I didn't tell you one thing. So, the total time taken at load port was 2 days, 11 hours, 30 minutes, which is roughly approximately around 59 hours. And we have total time given to us is 72 hours. So, we have around 13 hours left. So, if you see, you're here, 13 hours have already been consumed, 6 plus 3. 9 plus 12, again more than 13 hours. So because of this, we are already running into demurrage, so we know that we are on demurrage in this case. At 5 o'clock in the morning, it was rectified and it started commencing. At 10:45, the hose is disconnected. Even though the discharging finished at 10 o'clock, when does the hose get disconnected? At 10:45. Till that time, the lay time will count. And finally, we add all of this lay time at discharge port, which gives us 2 days, 3 hours. Now, this is the load port lay time used, which we have from the previous slide, which was 2 days, 11 hours, 30 minutes. When we add both of these figures, we get total lay time used as 04:14:30, which is obviously more than 72 hours, which is your 3 days. How much is excess for demurrage? Is 1 day, 14 hours, 30 minutes. When you subtract the total lay time used minus the total lay time allowed, we get time on demurrage. The total demurrage per day pro rata was given as $10,000 per day. In the absence of express provision, lay time runs on the vessel on demurrage. In this case, there are express provision excluding pump failure and shifting. Now, as per the question, the demurrage is given as $10,000 per day pro rata. You need to convert that figure per day pro rata to 38.5 hours, which we get 12,000. When we do that, we multiply this 12,000 with 38.5 hours, and finally we get demurrage as $16,042. This is the total demurrage amount. With this, we finish off our lecture. Thank you.
Since we have finished the lecture, I would like to hear out from you guys in the comment section below, and hit the like button if you like the video, guys. And one of the most important tips and feedbacks come from you guys, so feel free to connect with me on LinkedIn. So thanks for checking out the video, guys. Subscribe if you haven't already. In the next lecture, we'll be discussing upon the tanker voyage estimate. Until next time, ShipScope is bringing you the best platform to learn about the commercial shipping subjects. Keep on learning it, and we will talk soon.